Church. I'm delighted you're here, and I'm thankful that you didn't freeze last night. You were able to find your way to church this morning. It's wonderful, those of you who are here, those of you who are worshiping with us at home. We're delighted that you can do that, and hope that you stay warm and safe in this difficult weather situation that we have. I'm thankful to be back with you. Some of you know that last Sunday I was not here because my wife tested positive for the virus, and she is fine and completely past that, and I dodged a bullet somehow, so I'm thankful for that too, but I'm glad to be back with you. Today, after our worship ends, we will have a very, very brief annual meeting, and I hope as many of you can will stay after worship for the annual meeting. I'm going to promise to make it the shortest annual meeting we've ever had at Trinity Church, so if you will, please stay for that. I think you'll find it informative and quick and easy. Also, I'm going to mention this in my annual meeting, but we have some printed parish directories. If you don't have one, please pick one up. They're in, on the table across from the columbarium on your way out, near the front porch. It's a parish directory, so please get one of those on your way out. Let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Supplications of your people, and in our time grant us your peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "My Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a boy,' for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Since I was born, from my mother's womb, you have been my strength.
My praise shall be always of you.
Show me the way I should go.
Reading from 1 Corinthians. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly. But then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. And the greatest of these is love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.'" And he said, "Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Last week, in the Gospel reading, Jesus arrived in his hometown, preached from Scripture, from the book of Isaiah, that wonderful and great prophecy about hope, promise, that prophetic word about God's people having their needs met, God's people being freed from oppression, prison. Now Jesus stands in the midst of his own people and says, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Last week we heard Jesus say these words, and we hear them again this Sunday. The Gospel reading picks up near the end of last Sunday's reading. And so Jesus has just finished reading this wonderful prophecy of Isaiah in the midst of his own people, in the synagogue in his hometown. He's speaking to people who know him, people who saw him grow up, people who know where he came from. At first, this scripture reading tells us that his own people, his own townsfolk, were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. How wonderfully Jesus shares this prophecy of old from Isaiah with them. He lifted their spirits by the way he read the scripture, the way he unrolled the scroll and proclaimed with power God's promise. But then it doesn't take long for the situation to change. The people that are listening to Jesus proclaim this prophecy want something different. They want something different from Jesus. They want him to do exactly for them what Jesus has done elsewhere for some outsiders. At first, they hear Jesus proclaim this prophecy as good news. And then they start to think about it, and it seems different from what they want to hear. Jesus' words about being the fulfillment of what God had promised made them uncomfortable. And then the more they thought about it, it made them angry. And
And then it sent them into a rage. And then they wanted to kill Jesus. And there's a lot to consider in this gospel reading today. But maybe it's just all about the danger of preaching. Preaching is not easy. It may seem easy to you, but it's not always easy. And I have had occasions when people were not very happy with my sermons, but no one has tried to kill me yet. There's a wonderful old saying about the purpose of a sermon. The preacher is to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. Sometimes God's word does that. It grabs us, takes hold of us, shakes us up a bit, and sometimes even breaks us open. Jesus certainly made those who were listening to him that day very comfortable. But this is the Epiphany season, and the whole theme of this season is revelation. We are learning week by week as we examine these scripture readings who Jesus is. He is being revealed to the world. Who is this man named Jesus? Today he shows up in his own hometown, in the synagogue. He reads God's promises that were written long, long ago. Promises that were very familiar to those folks who were listening. But he adds something different. And he says, today, these scriptures are fulfilled in your hearing. In other words, he says, I am the fulfillment of God's promise. Jesus is saying that he is the fulfillment of God's power. It's the first of the many challenging things that Jesus will face in his earthly life and in his ministry. But his invitation for those who were listening that day was for them to see God in the person who was standing in front of them, Jesus himself. It was not what they expected, not what they thought those words of promise written long ago were all about. They were not able to hear the prophetic word that Jesus uttered that day because their minds were set in old patterns. Perhaps the key to understanding this complicated gospel story and the key to our hearing it today and understanding it rests in one word. And that word from the scripture reading today is today. Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus says, today, God's promises are fulfilled. In other words, he says, I am the fulfillment of all that God has promised from generation to generation to this present day. The heart of the matter with these hometown folks was that they were called to believe what Jesus said. Belief in what Jesus said. The heart of the matter for us is also belief. Are we ready to believe that Jesus has the power to bring hope to a hopeless world? Are we ready to believe that Jesus has the power to meet our needs today? Are we ready to believe that Jesus can set us free from all the things in our lives that have us bound, all the things that keep us imprisoned? Our destructive habits, sin, addictions, the wrong path that we may be on, our cycle of bad decisions. Our word from this gospel is today. Today. Today we are invited to set aside our old attitudes, our old worries, our old fears that we've carried for so long, our old patterns of living and thought, and believe. Today we are to believe that we have the freedom, the help, and the healing that comes from God in the person of Jesus Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may live our lives
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people. Strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repentant. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
Glory.
Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Therefore, let us keep the peace.
Hallelujah. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance. remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith.
Thank you.
in prayer together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us, living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world of peace. Grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed be God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Upon you and remain with you always. Amen.